What?
What a great morning so far. Anytime John 8 comes out for communion, you know it's going to be good. We're all very grateful, Sierra, just for your incredible message. That was awesome. And then the contribution I thought was so deep. I don't know if I've ever heard that deep of a contribution message before. I thought that was such a good one. I asked her during the fellowship break and said, would you please write it up into an article? Because I think there was so much good stuff in there that just kind of flew over our heads because she was just nailing it. And that was an awesome job, Tesh. And thank you so much for giving us the heart of a sacrificial disciple. That was awesome. I thought it's been just a great service. I thought Kim and Alondra did a great job. Just awesome. Just really, really awesome. Today we're going to be starting a 5-part series to finish out the month and ultimately the year. And you know, 2018 is going to be the year of grace. And so I was thinking that going into the new year, it's good to have an understanding of grace. And so I'm just calling this series Understanding Grace. And I really hope that these 5 Bible studies that we're going to do will really enlighten us and help us and deepen our relationship with God and ultimately help us to appreciate what true biblical grace is all about so that it can be active in our lives. So today is the first part, and we're going to be studying out Colossians chapter 3. Okay. I've got to mention this little necklace I got here, too. Okay. These are kukui nuts from Hawaii, and Kaiser went to Hawaii this week just to chill on the beach for a few days. That's what her Facebook looked like, anyways. And she came back with varying gifts for a Bible talk. And these are kukui nuts, and I thought I should wear them as some inspiration. They the nuts are used from ancient Hawaiians would use the nuts for the oils to light fires. Whoa. So we're gonna light a lot of fire today.
Okay. Right.
But unlike Sierra, we're not gonna run from the fire.
Wow.
It's gonna be awesome. Let's start off here with a word of prayer.
Okay. Amen.
Father, God, we just come before you, God, humbled by your calling and appreciative of the fact that you think that we are somewhat worthy of your kingdom, Father. Mm. We feel so unworthy, and God, in every way, like in John 8, Father, we feel like that we are those Pharisees, those teachers of the law who cannot cast any stones, Father, because we know that we've been forgiven of so much. And we just thank you, God, for Jesus' incredible example and the fact that we get to imitate him and follow in his footsteps. I pray that as we study out Colossians chapter 3 today, that we can really be inspired to make his life our life and that we will change today, that we will repent today. So that tomorrow and later on this afternoon, even we can be new people, Father, renewed by your grace. We love you. It's in your Son's name, Jesus, that we pray these things. Amen.
Amen.
You know, I've really transitioned from different musical genres over the years, but I've got to admit that in high school I was a big fan of R&B music. I mean, I listened to a lot of Boyz II Men.
Oh, yeah.
But maybe even some not so well known artists like Music Soul Child, Andy Ari. I was their biggest fan. I was listening to this music 24/7. You would never guess it, but I mean, even last night we were out to dinner with the Jordans, and an R&B song came on. I don't remember if it was Jagged Edge or what it was, but I just started singing along, and you know, it just was coming back. And you know, it's funny. There was a song that I actually never liked. But my sister was in love with it, and that's Casey and JoJo,
yes!
All My Life. I mean, I feel like if I just started singing it right now, you guys would join me.
Yeah, really. Yeah.
All my life, I pray for someone like you, and I thank God. Our relationship with God and our commitment level to who Jesus was. So the title of our message this morning is Christ is Your Life.
Wow.
Please turn to Colossians chapter 3. We're not going to venture too far out of Colossians today. I'm going to mention a lot of different verses, and I'm hoping you can write them down. But we're going to really stick to the scriptures this morning, and I pray that it'll speak to you as it did to me, and we can leave here inspired to make Christ our life. Amen. Point number one is raised with Christ. Amen. Colossians chapter 3, verse 1. Since then you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. We were raised with Christ.
Yeah.
We were raised with Christ. In Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 20, it says, "The Lord is your life." The Lord is your life. Christ is our life. Christ is your whole life. But this is a decision. Many people think that maybe this is mystical in a sense, or this is a phase that they may go through sometime. But when you make Christ your life, it's a decision that you've made, and it's called Jesus is Lord. The great, the good confession that Jesus made to Pilate of, hey, I am Lord, and then the good confession that we make at our baptism is Jesus is Lord, as Paul did in Acts 22:16. And that heart, that mindset, that conviction, Christ is our life. But we've got to remember that we were raised with Christ. We've got to be convinced that Jesus lived the greatest life any of us could ever dream of living. He was full of purpose. There's a show that Courtney and I are watching on Netflix. We haven't watched it all at all this week, but we were on a roll in the last few weeks. It's called Person of Interest. I don't know if you've seen it. We're using Delaney's account, so I'm sure she has noticed us watching it. But probably some nights when she wants to go watch Vampire Diaries or something, we were using her account. But we're watching a show called Person of Interest. It's a very awesome show. But essentially, I'm not going to go into it too much here, but essentially there's this guy who used to work for the government, and he was sort of used as a secret weapon, and they would send him all over the world, and he would take care of business. And he realized after a while that he was working for a corrupt government, and so he ends up faking his own death and just going off the grid. And the show starts with him sitting in a subway, and he's looking very straggly like a homeless guy, and just sort of given up on life altogether. I mean, at this point in his life, he's saved thousands of people, but he's also done some dirty work, and he's a very valuable asset. But he's not using his talents or his abilities because he doesn't trust the government. So this incredibly wealthy guy, whose net worth is infinite because he's created a machine that can literally spy on everybody in all of America. And so he's created this machine, this eye, so to speak, that can look through your cell phone or look through your computer screen or look through a security camera. And not only does it watch everything, but it calculates everything.
Wow.
And the machine can put together, you know, body gestures and conversations and things that people are doing in secret. And it puts it all together and it figures out who is next to be in danger. Who's going to be the victim of another homicide. And this wealthy quadrillionaire, it's so heavy on his heart that he knows who's going to die, who's going to be, you know, attacked, and he wants to do something about it. And so he uses the machine to find a person that can be his undercover Batman, so to speak, his little vigilante. And what he does is he finds this guy, and he goes up to him, and he goes, "I know who you are." And his response is so resentful. He goes, "You have no idea who I am." He goes, "I know exactly who you are. I know where you're from. I know the names of the family members." And he just lists these things. And he wins over the guy's attention. And he goes, "But you're missing just one thing." He goes, "What do you think I'm missing? I've got everything I need." He goes, "You need a purpose." And they start to work together. And this guy goes undercover, and he's 10 steps ahead of the FBI, and he's going out, he's handling business to protect good people and save people from becoming the next homicide victim in New York City.
Wow.
It's a really cool movie, but in every way, I think when we were raised with Christ, we became that person of interest.
Mm.
And now you've got these talents and abilities and potential, and God wants to use them in a great way, but the devil has got you down, and you're a homeless man living in the subway. Mm. And you need a purpose.
Come on, Joel.
You need a purpose. In every way, I think when we're raised with Christ, he elevates our life to new ways. Number one, I think that when you follow Christ and you're raised with Christ, you're elevated in your ambitions. I mean, take the Samaritan woman, for example. She's a woman who's committed adultery countless times. Jesus finds her. He gives her a purpose, and she goes out, and she starts telling everybody in the town, this man must be a prophet. He's told me everything I ever did. And her purpose becomes about now spreading the gospel of Jesus. And I think, as a disciple, we all did a very good job of, when you got baptized, repenting of your sin and giving up the selfish ambition that was involved in your life. But some of us have forgotten to take on spiritual ambitions. And it may not hit you right now, but I've seen it hit disciples 3, 4, 5 years down the road, where they take a step back and they look at their life and they go, oh my gosh, ever since I became a disciple, I got a worse job, making less money, I got fatter, and I'm still single. And they go, what's wrong? Where's my ambition? See, it's awesome to get rid of that selfish ambition. But then you got to use your talents for the Lord, multiply them.
Right.
Kind of like the parable of the talents in Matthew 25.
Right.
Multiply your talents, but now in the kingdom, and take on spiritual ambitions.
Amen.
I mean, to be very honest, guys, I look at a guy like Owen Hartley.
Come on.
This guy has learned not just to get rid of the selfish ambition, but to take on spiritual ambitions.
Yeah.
I was in New York City in 2011 as a campus minister. I lived in this tiny little apartment with a bunch of guys in Brooklyn, paying way too much for rent. And Owen lived all the way up in Harlem, and he would longboard to our house. You go, well, I don't get it. Okay, Harlem is very far away. Like 6 or 7 or 8 miles or something like that. And he would just longboard just to come to our house. He shows up, drenched in sweat, to a house where we can't afford air conditioning, cockroaches, you know, running in the corridors. And he'd just come and sit down on our leather couch, just leaving his imprint there. Not a lot of ambition. After a few years, he realized his life wasn't going anywhere, and he falls away. Gets discouraged, and he falls away. Then I hear that he gets restored in the Syracuse church. When Courtney and I moved out to Syracuse in 2013, it was a very small campus ministry. We brought with us a few people. We brought Gina with us. We brought James with us. And they were amazing. We brought another young girl as well. And we go there, and we were greeted by the campus ministry. And it's Owen and like 3 sisters. And in a very real way, they're all basically fallaways. And it's like, it's just a very sad situation. We had our first devotional at Nottingham High School. And we had this huge auditorium, and we barely filled up the first row. And I remember getting up there going, okay, well guys, we're going to change the world. And I mean, from that point on, we just saw Owen blossom and grow, and everyone else did as well. But it was so inspiring to watch this guy who I knew in 2011, who was struggling with life, then start to grow in his ambition and want to do great things for God. And he stands before you today, and I hope that you can appreciate the transformation that the Lord has done in his life. He's elevated his ambitions, and I know he's dreaming of even greater things down the road. But you know, being a disciple also elevates our personality. You know, very often, many of us, when we get off of home, get off of work or whatever, we go home and kind of close ourselves in our room, watch a little TV, take a little nap, fall asleep. Before you know it, you wake up, it's time for dinner, eat some food, go back to the TV, and go to bed because, you know, you gotta wake up early the next day for work. And that really describes a lot of people's lives.
Yeah.
But then in the kingdom, God elevates your personality. You become a more outgoing person, a more giving, a more sacrificial, a more serving. And now you're invigorated to do great things for God and give and serve others.
Yeah.
You know, I see people in the kingdom that they come in, they're kind of introverted. They're kind of quiet, which is not wrong. It's not bad at all to be introverted. You can be a frank and decide, we'll be an introvert. But you know, they're very kind of quiet, keeping themselves. But then over time, the Lord really transforms their personality. And all of a sudden, they're this super outgoing, giving, playing violin and playing piano. And it really is amazing how Christ can elevate our personalities in the kingdom. I think of passages like 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5, where it says, take captive your thoughts and make them obedient to Christ. I mean, you can have these insecure, you can have these sad, discouraging, quiet moments, and then if you grab a hold of it, add Christ, you can flip it around and become more Christ-like and elevate your personality. Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
And it's not like a temporary thing that you just, you know, put on this show when you show up to church. No, you stay that way. You're rewired in a sense.
Yeah.
I love the fact that when we become disciples, we're raised with Christ, we get elevated in our relationships.
Right.
Deep relationships.
Yeah.
Not many of us had deep relationships in the world because you didn't trust anybody.
Right.
No. You barely trusted your family.
Right.
It was hard to give your heart to anybody because you were afraid of getting crushed.
Yeah. Right.
And then you come around the kingdom, and now everybody's in a place where we just need to trust somebody. We trust each other, and our relationships get so tight.
Yeah.
You know, I love the fact that this is truly represented around the kingdom when you just look at the diversity of the room. I don't know if there's another room this diverse in the city of Seattle right now.
Wow.
I mean, I don't know. I thought it was awesome seeing Owen lead a song with Aaron singing over here, white lady, and Xiaoxi singing over here, Asian lady. I mean, it doesn't get much more diverse than that. I mean, I was in Peach Kingdom this morning, and I'm sitting there preaching to Gilbert, Mexican guy, Naila, mixed with a bunch of stuff. I think she's Samoan, she might be. And it's not rare that you enter into a room with other disciples and you look around and you go, only in the kingdom.
Right.
I mean, let's be real. We wouldn't necessarily be friends with each other because we grew up prejudiced or we grew up not trusting. And yet in the kingdom, there's so much incredible diversity that we can elevate our relationships. You know, when you're raised with Christ, your whole life turns around.
Yeah.
Everything gets taken to another level. You now have the ability to keep in step with the Spirit and allow discipleship to influence every aspect of your life. You're renewed, in a sense. That's point number two, renewed in Christ. Let's continue reading verse 5. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature. Sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived, but now you must rid yourselves of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. Here, there is no Greek or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. We're renewed in Christ. Our environment is renewed in Christ. Too many people make the mistake of thinking that repentance is the key to getting into the kingdom, and then they don't keep that heart. Jesus teaches in Matthew 3:8 and Luke 3:8, or not Jesus, John the Baptist, bear fruit in keeping with repentance. You keep with repentance. We're being renewed day after day after day.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
I mean, to get into the kingdom, we've changed jobs. We've postponed relationships. We get radical in so many ways with the purpose of getting right with God.
Right.
And yet what it says in the very beginning here is keep your mind and your heart set on things above where Christ is seated. Our vision needs to go beyond the waters of baptism and all the way up into heaven. And when that becomes your ambition and your focus, you get renewed not just one time, but every day.
Right.
Do you still have the do whatever it takes mentality?
Yeah.
I mean, we know from Acts chapter 14, Paul's conviction is, listen, you've got to go through many hardships to enter the kingdom of God.
Yeah.
But let me tell you guys another truth. We go through many hardships to stay in the kingdom of God.
Yeah.
And most of the hardships we put on ourselves. Yeah. We beat our bodies. We make ourselves a slave to righteousness.
Yeah.
The hardest part was to get in. And now the hardship we face is really on us to train ourselves to be godly.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think these are our three greatest challenges to being renewed in Christ every day. Number one, you've got to keep your relationship with God fresh every day.
Yeah.
Fresh every day. You know, people get so caught up in, you know, this box of Christianity. And I've just been so enlightened in the last 6 months to feel freed from that box.
Yeah.
Just to really learn what it means to walk with God.
Yeah.
I mean, I've been a Christian now almost 15 years. And I can truly say in the last 6 months, I've learned more about just walking with God.
Mm-hmm.
Living as a disciple.
Right, yeah.
Making my walk with God more than just an hour of a quiet time in the morning.
Right.
But really walking with God. Making daily investments that I know are going to help my relationship with God. Sure, quiet times. But prayer times. Fellowship times. Times of meditation where I can just sit and think and focus on the things that really matter in life. Secondly, I think one of our challenges is to have impactful quiet times every day.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And we can take that for granted and sit here and go, oh, I do that. I don't know. I don't know if we really understand what it means to dig into the scripture so much so that it has a deep impact every single day.
Yeah.
You know what I think? I don't think it's possible to fall away if you're having great quiet times every day.
Wow.
I don't think it's possible. I don't think that there is any amount of pain that a person can put you through that would make you turn your back on God's kingdom.
Yeah.
I don't think that there's anything that a preacher could say from a pulpit that would turn you off so much against the Bible you'd want to walk away. I don't think that a roommate could hurt you enough to make you fall away.
Yeah.
I don't think that there's any number on the missions contribution that would make you want to fall away.
Yeah.
I think if somebody is walking with God and having great quiet times every day, then because of your relationship with God being so strong and your faith being so significant, I don't think that you'd ever fall away.
Right. Come on, Joel.
I don't think you ever would. I don't even think it would be a thought in your mind.
Right. Come on.
You go, well, I thought about it, and I read every day. That's the problem. You're reading every day.
Right. Yeah.
There it is.
A quiet time is not fully composed of reading.
Right. Yes.
You did that for school, and you barely remember anything you learned. This has to be studied. This has to be a time that's invested in it. It could be 15 minutes. I've had amazing quiet times that were only 15 minutes long.
Mm-hmm.
And I've had lame quiet times that were 2 hours long.
Yeah.
It's not about the quantity, it's about the quality.
Yeah.
Great quiet times every day.
Right.
I love Titus chapter 2. It says that grace teaches us to say no to ungodliness.
Right.
I think if you're learning the grace of God from the scriptures, I don't think that you're going to feel tempted beyond what you can bear. I mean, we know 1 Corinthians 10:13 promises us you'll never be tempted beyond what you can bear. God won't allow it. But sometimes we can still feel like we're being tempted beyond what we can bear.
Yeah.
But I think if you're really in step with the Spirit and you understand the grace of God and you're close to God, deeper than you have ever been every day, I don't think that the temptation is ever going to be too overwhelming.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Paul's in chains and he goes, guys, I'm fired up. How about you? I don't think that there's any amount of persecution that's going to harm your relationship with God when you're having great quiet times every day.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a relative term. I mean, a great quiet time for you might be different than a great quiet time for me.
Right.
Very often I ask somebody, I go, so how's your quiet time going? They're like, well, you know, I'm kind of stuck in the book of Leviticus right now. I'm trying to get through it. I'm like falling asleep every three verses, and there's not a lot to it. I've got no problem telling everybody, hey, listen, switch up your quiet time. Keep it fresh. There's 65 other books you can read. There's a lot of scriptures in this one book that should keep you excited about your quiet time every day. And I always tell people, if you're reading something that doesn't fire you up, sometimes it might be an issue of repentance, and you got to approach it with a different perspective. sometimes you just gotta switch it up. Mm-hmm. Pick up another book, another topic, another character, and study and have a great quiet time. It's gonna impact your heart, not just your head.
Right.
Thirdly, I think our challenge is maintaining friendships.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, it's awesome to be a part of a growing church. We started the year off with 31 members. By June, we were at 28 members. And we were in every way the fastest shrinking church in the tribal sector. I mean, we were not growing. And then Janelle gets baptized. And then Virginia gets baptized.
Yeah.
And all these other people get baptized. And since June, we've gone from 28 to 45 disciples.
Wow.
45. Isn't that awesome?
Yeah. Yes.
It's not to our credit. It's by the grace of God that He's multiplied the church so fast. That's encouraging.
Yeah.
That's exciting. You realize we haven't had someone fall away since April.
Yeah.
That's to the glory of God. You guys look shocked right now. I'm shocked. It's the grace of God. It's to the glory of God. And yet, as the church is growing, we've got to maintain friendships. You see, right now, you have your little core of friends, right? There's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with that. Because you need those people to keep you encouraged every day.
Yeah.
But one of the challenges we have is expanding that bubble.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And letting some of the new people in. And if you don't, then it looks like you're still a faction.
Mm-hmm.
So this is okay as long as you're willing to grow.
Right.
And bring in new people. And you're always going to be multiplying in your relationships. You know, in the world, we're taught that you have a best friend. Then you get baptized and you're like, I can't pick. We have so many best friends. And that's how it ought to be. And the cool thing about it is we have friends all over the world. But maintaining those friendships can be a challenge. And sometimes people will isolate themselves and give up altogether, which is very dangerous. It's very dangerous. Because you cannot be a part of Christ and not a part of His body, as Colossians 1 teaches. So you've got to maintain those relationships in the kingdom, and that can be a challenge. But you know, being crucified continually doesn't sound very appealing. I mean, killing our sin on a regular basis doesn't sound very appealing. But you know what? It is appealing. I'm encouraged that I can crucify my sinful nature every day. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was not happy with who I was in the world.
Yeah.
I was not happy with the habits that I had. I was not happy with the friends that I was, that, you know, the little friend groups I was a part of. I was not happy. It was not the life that I knew God wanted me to live.
Yeah.
And then I get baptized. Then I become a disciple. And now I have so many options of who I want to love. And it's just so incredible that God gives us the ability to be renewed every day.
Yeah.
You've got to believe that God wants you to be happy.
Right.
He wants you to be happy. Renewed every day. When you're being renewed, you feel refreshed.
Yeah.
You look happy.
Right.
And happiness is not defined in the kingdom by the stuff that you have. It's not defined by your circumstances. It's defined by the contentment, the satisfaction that you find in your relationship with God. I mean, Christ has got to be your life.
Right.
Not just when you're baptized, but renewed forevermore. You guys with me?
Yeah.
Point number three. Point number three. Ruled by Christ. Ruled by Christ. Colossians 3:12. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. As members of one body, you were called to peace, and be thankful. Ruled by Christ. You know, to some, this doesn't look very appealing. I mean, these attributes look kind of girly to the men. And to the sisters, you go, well, if I do that, men are going to take advantage of me. And yet, think about the people that have had the most influence in your life over the years. They probably carry some of these attributes. These are new attitudes. These are new characteristics that the Lord wants us to take on so that we can be perfectly united in Christ. These qualities are not weak-willed. They are not soft. These are firm, foundational qualities that will keep you solid in your relationship with God and not just help you in your own walk with God, but influence other people's walks with God.
Yeah.
You know, the standard of these qualities is not just out to the leaders. I'm not just talking to Bible Talk leaders right now. This standard of commitment and heart commitment is for every disciple
right.
of the church.
Right.
Front to back, left to right, old to young.
Right.
It's for everybody.
Right.
And when we understand that, then we really want to hold each other accountable to having this heart.
Come on, bro.
The expectations that Paul is putting on here is on the entire church. Mm. It's for all of us to be focused on these qualities. I love how at the very end here it says, with all these things, you've got to put on love, which binds them together in
right.
perfect unity.
Yeah.
It's one thing to show up to church, right?
Yeah.
But love kind of fills in the gaps and binds it together.
Mm-hmm.
You have D time. You're committed to your discipling time every week, but you got to do it in love.
Mm-hmm.
You show up to Bible Talk, but you got to do it in love.
Mm-hmm.
You got to give your missions and all that other stuff, but you got to do it in love.
Right. Wow.
It's the love that binds it all together.
Mm-hmm.
If your heart is not in the right place, you can be going through all the motions and still not feel a part of things.
That's a good point.
In fact, you come together and everyone else does it in love and you still sit in the back with a bad attitude, crossing your arms, looking unhappy. This is not a phase that we go through.
Right.
We've all got to do it in love.
Right.
Yeah.
So that we can be perfectly united in Christ.
Come on.
Amen. Come on.
We've all been this guy.
Yeah.
Right?
Oh, yeah.
We've all been this guy. You understand that, right?
Yeah.
You've been this guy. You've struggled before.
Yeah.
You've showed up to a meeting in the body and you feel alone.
Mm-hmm.
Just like when I lived in New York City, millions of people, and you walk down the street, you feel so lonely. You feel like this guy, right? You look around, everyone's happy. It's like, hey, we've all been there. We've come to church like that. We've come to Bible Talk like that. You don't even want to go to Bible Talk. We've all been there before. And you look at this list and you go, this is impossible. That's just not who I am. You feel stuck. Listen. The peace of Christ will rule in your hearts when Jesus is Lord of your life.
Amen.
I mean, think about it. Entire religions are devoted to figuring out the peace of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Entire religions. Buddhism, Hinduism,
yep.
Sikhism, Jainism. Things are practiced to find peace. Meditation. Things are searched out to find peace. Enlightenment. People devote their lives to finding peace. And I'm telling you, you sit here today as a true disciple, you already have it. You may need to dust it off a little bit, but it's there. When Christ is ruling in your life, you have the peace of Christ. You have the encouragement from Christ. This is not something you need to go out and find and study out. Just make the decision to have the peace of Christ in your life.
Amen.
The only true peace we have in life is from Christ.
Yeah.
You put your peace in everything, in anything else, and it doesn't last.
That's, right.
That's why people that are practicing these other religions have to set aside a part of the day to refine it.
Mm.
A true disciple doesn't have to go refine it.
Right.
He's just got to make the decision again to do it.
Right.
And to feel it and to enjoy it in the kingdom. And this is a household that Jesus is running. Let me tell you, when Jesus is running his household, he wants everyone to show up to dinner.
Yeah.
That's how Jesus wants it. He expects everybody to be home for dinner. He expects a wholesomeness in all the relationships.
Mm-hmm.
He expects us to work out our differences, to bear with each other.
Yeah.
I always say it's funny, you said we gotta bear with each other. You know, some people are easier to bear with than others, let's just be honest.
Yeah.
But this is the household of God. This is the church. This is the kingdom. We are a family.
Amen.
This is not real world.
Right.
This is not a frat house where all we have in common is the kitchen. We are a family. And we're together. And we're in this together. You know, 2018 is going to be the year of grace.
Wow. Yeah.
Which is very exciting.
Yeah.
Very exciting. I mean, I really think it's funny because 1 Corinthians 15:10 is the theme scripture for the whole year. And it just says, you know, Paul's explaining his heart to be motivated. He says the grace of God was not without effect. But you gotta finish the verse.
Yeah.
I think a lot of people think that the year of grace is gonna mean that it's gonna be the feel good year. the more hugs year. The more encouragement year. Let's get to the second half of the verse. What's the second half of the verse? No, God's grace is not without effect. I work harder than all of them. We can call it the year of grace, but let's be real. It's gonna be the year of hard work. It's gonna be the year of let's work harder than we've ever worked. And I think that we've got to go into 2018 with that mindset and understanding that it's gonna be a cranking year. We're gonna let the grace of God motivate us in new ways to work harder than we've ever worked for Him before.
Right.
The only way you're gonna make it through 2018 alive is if you let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. Otherwise, you're gonna wake up every day dreading the Bible talk, dreading the work schedule, dreading it. But if you got the peace of Christ, it's going to be a joy.
Right.
It's going to be a joy. 2018 Winter Workshop.
Yeah.
January 5th through 7th. Yeah. Down in Tukwila at the Embassy Suites. Woo! Everyone's invited. In fact,
yes.
I hope everybody goes. Yes. $35 registration. Please do it ASAP. Friday morning is a Church Builders Workshop. We call it Church Builders Workshop because it's optional. You don't have to go. I hope all the leaders go. I hope that all the soon-to-be leaders go. And I really hope that everybody goes. Mm-hmm. I'm encouraging everybody to take that Friday off work.
Yeah.
You're not going to regret it. Just take it off work. It's the only time that all of the Pacific Northwest churches are going to be together all year long. Take it off work. Let's have a blast together.
Right.
But set up your schedule ahead of time so that the Winter Workshop is amazing for you.
Come on.
My prayer is that it will be the year of hard work. But more than that, I hope that we have the peace of Christ ruling in our hearts.
Right.
So we can make it through alive.
Come on.
Point number four. Rich in Christ's word. Verse 16. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, and as you sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. Rich in God's Word. You know, a lot of people know about the Bible. In fact, the Bible's being preached in churches all over the world right now as we speak. I've had people in the last couple of weeks come to me and say, Joel, why are we talking about other churches? I feel like we need to talk about other churches.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
Not because the other church, for the sake of just doing it. I think that there's an idea of grace that's being preached in other churches that is not biblical.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just going to be forthright with you. I don't think it's biblical.
Right.
I don't think it's right for people to show up every Sunday and sit down and think that they're getting the grace of God by doing nothing.
Yeah, one point.
Let me give you a challenge. Study out grace for the remainder of the year.
Wow.
Study it out. And I guarantee you, I've done it. I guarantee you, you will not find one verse in the whole Bible that teaches that grace is unmerited. It's always merited. It's always earned. You've done something to get the grace of God. You don't just show up to church and have grace. There is a lifestyle that God expects you to live. Study it out. Look it up for yourself. But I pray that you will become rich in God's word. The word of Christ dwells in you. It lives in you. I mean, too many people are not rich in the word. They don't really get this. It lives in you. This isn't like, you know, the extended family that just shows up for Christmas and Easter. No, they live in your house. This isn't, the Christ's word is not like your aunts and uncles that may just show up for your wedding and your funeral. It lives in you. The word of God lives in you. You're not just going to hear it at Christmas and Easter. You're not just going to hear it Sunday mornings. It lives in you. 24/7. It's active in your life. There are so many applications of the Bible to our life. In fact, the Bible can be used in every area of your life. Relationships. Finances. How you look for future spouses. Working out your relationships as far as figuring out your differences. How you create your schedule. Putting together budgets. I mean, every single area of our lives is affected by the Word of God.
Yeah.
A person who is living by God's word can only do so because God's word is living in them.
Right.
It's the only way to do it. You know, using the Bible on a regular basis in every area of your life is completely consuming. It's completely consuming. I tried something this last week. It didn't go very good. It was very challenging. But literally, any decision that I made outside the house, I tried to make it with a scripture. It was very challenging. I forgot to do it most of the time. But the times I thought about it, it was really enriching. I mean, I felt awesome. It was encouraging to know the Bible's applicable at the grocery store.
Yep.
The Bible's applicable at the bank. The Bible's applicable everywhere I go. Isn't that awesome?
Yeah.
And I really tried. I tried to think of scriptures that I could apply in every area of my life. Try to do it. It's very challenging, but it's enriching. You feel so much closer to God when you do it. It's exciting. It's invigorating. There's nothing like living by the Bible.
Yeah.
When God's word is living in you, there's no room for guilt. It's liberating. You feel so good all the time. You know that you're close to God. When you live your life modeled after the life of Christ, it's so invigorating, you will never regret it. You know, we talked about being raised with Christ, being renewed in Christ, being ruled by Christ, being rich in Christ. I believe that this is the formula for making Christ your life. Don't just make Christ your life for the worship service Sunday morning.
Right.
Live for Christ. Let's enter 2018 refreshed in Christ.
Yeah.
So that in 2018, we can run for Christ.
Yeah.
Make Christ your life. Let's talk about this and study this stuff out this week.
Yeah.
And I guarantee you will understand the grace of God.
Yeah.